Well, as we are being joined by all our other campuses across Chicagoland, I want to welcome you, and I want to let you know that I'm so glad you're here. I'm glad that you came to church today, because coming to church can be an expression of telling God that you want to submit to His will. And that's why we gather here, to lift high the name of Jesus and to hear from His word. And we want to submit to God's will. God's will for your life is for you to be holy. That's what His will for your life is. He wants to change you. He wants to make you pure and blameless. That's what it means to be holy. But He didn't leave us on our own to do this. He provided everything that you need to be able to be transformed. First, He gave you the church. This is your provision. You're not supposed to be doing this alone. We're supposed to be doing it together, and that's why we love gathering every single weekend, because we want to be made holy as we do it together as a church family. He gave you His church, but then He also gave you His word. God gave you His word. It's a more sure word of prophecy that you can trust on. You can bank on everything that God has said, and He's given you the church. He's given you the word, but then He gave you this. He gave you His spirit. God gave you Himself. And if you are a child of God, the Spirit of God dwells inside of you. And one of the things that He does is that as we are studying God's word today, some words are going to start jumping out at you. Some things are going to start clicking and making sense. And that is a work of the Holy Spirit. He illuminates God's word to us. And I'm so thankful that we have the church, that we have His word, and that we have His spirit. You know, I've been praying all week for this message. I've just been praying all week, and it's been a twofold prayer. The first prayer, honestly, I've been coming to this weekend with a joyful expectation, because I have seen of the blessing that will come to those who receive this message from God's word. And there's a joyful expectation in that. I can't wait to see it. But the other prayer I've had to pray has been a prayer that I've been grieving over. I've already shed many tears as I've prayed this week, because I know that not everyone will receive this message. And that grieves my heart. And so today, as I'm preaching, you start rationalizing, saying, oh, this is for someone else. And you start thinking, this is for my friend. This is for someone else in this church. If you're just trying to rationalize away God's word, I'm just begging you today, please don't do that. Please don't do that. Receive God's word. Hear what He has to say, for it can change you. Only God can change the heart. Please don't harden your heart today. Because here in 2 Chronicles chapter 7, God is going to give you a conditional statement. It's the second week of our series, If Then. If Then is a conditional statement. And God gives us a conditional statement. And the awesome thing about that is, when God gives you a conditional statement, He reveals to you that He's willing. He's willing to do the then if you and I are willing to do the if. And if we do what God has called us to do, then I believe in faith that God will revive our hearts. God will revive our hearts. Now, I know that as soon as I say the word revive or revival, to the American ear, that could mean many things. That could maybe you start thinking about like tent meetings or itinerant preachers, or you start thinking about names like Jonathan Edwards and the First Great Awakening, the Second Great Awakening. And while all those things were revival, I don't want you to feel like it's something so distant and it's something that has to stay in the past. See, revival is available today, because they didn't find some code in Scripture that it's like once they applied that code, then they saw what God's word said, and then they were able to find the favor of God. That's not what they did. And it also wasn't random. It wasn't just this random set of events that led to revival. What is behind every great move of God is you see Him working in people's hearts to believe what He's already said. It's right here. The principles of revival are right here in Scripture. It's a returning to the Lord. That's what it is. God revives your heart if you return to Him. Every historic move of God started in the heart. And if you like to jot things down, here's the sentence we're going after today. It's, the heart of revival is revival in the heart. At the center of all the things that God does when He revives, it starts in your heart. And if you desire revival, if you want to see that, you can have that today. But it needs to start in your heart and in my heart. And you will experience it if you do this if. if you do this if that we're going to be studying in 2 Chronicles chapter 7. Let me pray first. Father, we come before you expectant to hear from you, and we know we will, for we will be hearing from your word. God, we're asking for you to do the thing that only you can do, that you would change our hearts, that you would shine a light on our heart and reveal the things that we can't see. And Lord, we want to give you our yes, that if you do that, we want to respond and say yes. And Father, we'll give you all the glory for it, for you're worthy of that. That's in the name of Jesus we pray. All God's people said, amen. 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 All right, 2 Chronicles chapter 7, we're going to be studying the second part of verse 14. But just as a reminder, this passage comes right after the dedication of the temple of Solomon. And you have to remember that that's somewhere around the 10th century. So it's in the 900s before Christ. And interestingly enough, this book, 2 Chronicles, isn't written until some 500 years after all these things had transpired. That is very significant because the chronicler, the writer of the book, is saying, hey, I need to write this down and tell it to this generation of God's people because the principles of what happened at the dedication of the temple need to still be applied today. There's things that are beneficial for us today, 500 years after that, and that's when the chronicler writes this book. And one of the main themes in the book is the contrast between seeking the Lord and forsaking the Lord. So in the book, proper worship was seeking the Lord, and then failure to properly worship God was forsaking the Lord. And then faithfulness to God was seeking the Lord, and apostasy was forsaking the Lord. It's one of the themes that are in the book. And what the chronicler is doing is he's urging the people of God to seek the Lord. And that's the same thing I'm doing here today. I'm urging you to seek the Lord. Seek the Lord. So how are we going to do that? Well, we're going to follow the instructions the Lord gave Solomon in 2 Chronicles chapter 7. For in this verse lies the truth that we're after today, that the heart of revival is revival in the heart. I'm going to start reading at verse 13. It says, when I shut up the heavens so that there is no rain, or command the locusts to devour the land, or send pestilence among my people, if my people who are called by my name humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven and will forgive their sin and heal their land. So verse 13 gives us the when. It speaks to the when. So there's going to be an if-then statement, but it shows up when? When God's people are in desperate need of God. And are we there today? Are you there today? Are you desperately in need of God? I would suggest to you, we are. We're always going to be there. We need to stay there. And then we see these four things that are listed in verse 14, four things that they humble themselves, they pray, they seek his face, and they turn from their wicked ways. This isn't like a sequential checklist, so don't think of it as like step one, two, three, four. It's much more describing the kind of person that we need to be to fit the description of this if. It's more like facets of an active attitude before God that will show itself in tangible expressions. So what's our first point? We're just going to go through them one at a time. The first one is right there, that they humble themselves. Our first point is that we need to walk in humility. We need to walk in humility. First, notice whose job it is to do this. It's right there in the passage, humble themselves. God's saying it's your job to humble yourself. I want you to do this. And it's your job, it's my job to humble myself. And we have to define this a little bit better because sadly, the concept of humility in the church is even dictated a lot by what culture has taught us. And we have to get rid of those concepts and make sure we're sticking to what God's word teaches about humility so that we are honoring God with the way we think about it. So here's a definition that I find helpful and very practical. Humility is choosing a lower position before God and others, and it's the actions that flow from that position. Humility is choosing a lower position before God and others and the actions that flow from that position. See, humility is the conqueror of the great sin that is pride. When someone is proud, then they humble themselves. That pride cannot coexist with humility, and therefore it's cast out. But the enemy wants to give your heart the illusion of humility in order to grow a pride in you because of your fake humility, and so leave you alone, knowing that your pride forfeits the favor of God. And this is not a new concept, and it's not a small concept either. This is all throughout the scripture. Let's just go back to Genesis chapter 1. What do we see? Where do we see humility? Well, it's the position before God. So we see God say, I am creator, and mankind is the created. Man and woman are the ones that I have created, and though he gave them dominion over the land, he is still saying, I'm the creator, and you are the ones I've created. And then Satan falls out of heaven because of the pride that he had, and he spreads that poison of pride to Adam and Eve, and he convinces them to not believe the things that God has said. And what happens? They lose their humility, and they start thinking what they think is more important than what God thinks. They start thinking their opinions are greater than the opinions of the Creator himself, and so mankind loses its humility. And it would never be able to achieve it again, to discover humility again, without the work of God himself, without his grace. And so what God does is, out of heaven, he sends humility to earth in the form of Jesus Christ, his Son. And he is born in humility, not like a king, as expected on earth, but as a baby. He's born in humility. He lives in humility, serving others, loving others, and humility even to the point of death. He dies in humility. And as I was studying this week, and I knew I was going to talk about this concept of humility, you see all these people we can learn from across history, and then I started seeing the principles of Jesus in Scripture in regards to humility, and I was like, forget all those examples. Here's the example we have. You want to learn about humility? Study what Jesus did, and study what he said about humility, for he is the great example of what it means to humble yourself. So here are four lessons that we can learn from Jesus directly on humility. The first is this: humility is cultivated in the heart. Matthew 11, 29, Jesus says, learn from me. He's saying, I'm teaching you. Learn from me, for I am gentle and lowly in heart. That word lowly could be translated humble. I'm humble in heart. I've taken a lower position. Where? In my heart. The place where humility is cultivated is internal. It will show up in actions that flow from that, but it has to be cultivated in your heart first. But it's not only cultivated in your heart. Second thing we can learn from Jesus on humility is that humility is put to action in service. Matthew 23, verse 11 says this: The greatest among you in the kingdom of God shall be your servant. The greatest among you shall be your servant. He not only says it there, but he also gives the example. He says that the Son of Man didn't come to be served, but to serve. What humility is there? Because humility is put to action in service. The next lesson we learn from Jesus is that humility is obedient to the point of death. Philippians chapter 2, verses 5 through 8. Have this mind among yourselves, which is yours in Christ Jesus. Now, every time you're studying God's word, make sure your ears perk up when you hear, this is yours in Christ Jesus. Have this mind among yourselves. He's saying, apply the principles right here to yourself, because this is yours in Christ Jesus, who though he was in the form of God, did not count equality with God a thing to be grasped, but he made himself nothing, taking the form of a servant, being born in the likeness of men and being found in human form, he humbled himself. He humbled himself by becoming obedient even to the point of death. He humbled himself by going towards death. Humility is the groundwork that will lead you to death. And the death that we desire is the death to self. I want my flesh, my evil desires, I want that dead. And Jesus is saying, if you want that dead, humility is the way you're going to get there. positioning yourself low before God and others and letting the actions flow from that position, that is the groundwork where you will be able to die to self. And it starts making sense when Paul in Galatians 2:20, he says, I am therefore crucified with Christ. And it's no longer I who live, but Christ who lives within me. How do you get there? It's humility. It's humility, and we know that because of the example in Philippians chapter 2 of Jesus Christ, that he humbled himself by becoming obedient even to the point of death. And then finally, this fourth lesson from Jesus on humility. Humility is the prerequisite to exaltation. Humility is the prerequisite to exaltation. Now, you don't hear a lot of preaching on the concept of exaltation, really, these days. Exaltation of man. We talk a lot about exalting God, but this principle of the fact that God will exalt you is in the scripture time and time again. So let's just picture exaltation as that. I hear a lot of people talking about, like, I want this door to open in my life. There's something there that I desire, and I think it would be awesome, and I would use it for God, and I'm asking him to open that door. So an exaltation, imagine it as that opening of that door. And what Jesus teaches in Matthew chapter 23, verse 12, he says, whoever exalts himself will be humbled, but whoever humbles himself will be exalted. So if you want that door to open in your life, God says, if you take the job of busting that door open, I will humble you. But if you take the job of humbling yourself, you let me open that door. I will take care of the exaltation. And this is everywhere throughout Scripture. It's not just right here. Proverbs 3:34 says, towards the scorners he is scornful, but to the humble he gives favor. James chapter 4, verse 6 says, but he gives more grace. Therefore, it says, God opposes the proud, but gives grace to the humble. Then in verse 10, he says, humble yourselves before the Lord, and he will exalt you. 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 6, humble yourselves before God so that at the proper time, he may exalt you. How many more times does God need to say this again and again and again so that we get it? Humble yourself. Humble yourself. Humble yourself, for only if you do that, then will come the exaltation. This is what God's word teaches. Only then will come the exaltation. But let me clarify a few things about exaltation, because you can end up in a really bad place theologically if you don't apply the biblical principles of exaltation. So in Philippians chapter 2, after the part I just quoted, comes the exaltation of Jesus Christ, and it's his example that we can pull these principles from. Therefore, God has highly exalted him. And the passage continues, and here are the things that I see in that passage that teach us about exaltation. Well, the first one is really straightforward. First, the Father exalts the Son, so we learn that God is the one who does the exalting, not you, not me. We do the humbling, God does the exalting. And then he's not only the one who does it, but then he also decides how to exalt you. God is the one who decides how to exalt you. So if that door opens, you don't get to tell God what's on the other side of that door. You don't get to go through the door and be like, God, I said it needed to be this. No, no, no. That's God's decision. The way he chooses to exalt you is his choice. But God not only decides how, God also decides when. Right? We just read it in 1 Peter chapter 5. He says, at the proper time. God is the one who will decide when. And we end up in such a bad place when we start giving God our timelines. We say, God, we need that door to open today. Today, God. And it has to be today. Well, no, that it's his job. It's his job. He knows when. He's the only one who's all-knowing. There's been times I've prayed for God to open a door, and then he doesn't. And then 2 years later, he does open that door. And I look back, and I say, thank you, God, that you didn't open that door 2 years later, because I would have messed that up big time. It scares my heart to know that what if he opens something, and then I don't even give him the glory. And I start thinking about me. I say, God, please close all those doors. I don't want any of those doors to open. And that's why I trust him with the time of all doors. All exaltations, you leave it in God's hand. He knows what he's doing. And then the last point is that God exalts you for his own glory. At the end of that passage in Philippians 2, it says, for the glory of the Father. The Father exalts the Son for the glory of the Father. The principle being, anytime God exalts you, it's for his glory. That's why he does it. And so you don't have to be spending too much time thinking about what an exaltation could or couldn't be. You need to spend all that time focusing on humbling yourself. That's the biblical principle. How do I choose to take a lower position before God and others, and what are the actions that flow from that position? And see, as much as a gifting from God can be a blessing, it can also be a curse. Because as we are gifted in any area, if the enemy can get you to focus on your gift instead of focusing on the giver of the gift, then humility is exchanged for pride. You know, that reminds me of back in 2006 when I had graduated high school, and so then I grew up in Mexico City, then I moved to the States, and I moved to Virginia at Liberty University, and I'm a freshman, and that first semester, honestly, was just a really dark few months for me, because I had left everything I knew, to be honest. I left my family, and thankfully my sister was at college, so I was very thankful for that, but she was the only person who knew me at all. Everyone else was just like, no one knows who Eddie Hoagland is, and I was just like meeting friends, everyone for the first time, and so I felt like I'd lost my friends. I had lost most of my family, though I was thankful for my sister. I still felt that loss of I'm not even near my parents anymore, and we're far away, not just like a quick drive home. No, we're far away, we're countries apart. And then I also felt like I'd lost my culture, because even though I speak English well because my dad was an American, I'm hanging out with people who are completely in a different culture. See, the American culture, it's not just like you can read the dictionary and understand it. No, there's all these nuances of how you guys use words, and you have to spend time figuring out, oh, that means this in this context. There's all those things. Those are cultural things. And I remember sitting in this culture and feeling like, man, I feel like a foreigner. I feel such like a foreigner in this land, even though I can speak the language well. And I felt so alone. And I started auditioning for everything I could, because I had been leading worship since I was 15. And I'm like, I want to use my gifting for God. So I just kept on auditioning. I auditioned for scholarship teams. I auditioned for volunteer positions. I auditioned for any ministry, any small group that would let me use my gifting to lead people in worship. And every single door closed. Every single one of them. And I sat in my dorm room grieving over the fact. I'm like, God, but you gave me this gifting. Why don't I get to use it for you? It doesn't make sense. And so I was walking on the campus one day, and I came by, we had this prayer chapel, and I felt led to go in there. And I go in there, and I don't think there was anyone there that day. And I get on my knees, and I just start expressing my heart to God, and I start just telling him, God, this is so hard for me. I feel so alone. I feel like right now, if I went to dinner, no one would know I went to dinner. I just felt so alone. And it was in that moment that God impressed something on my heart. And I got to tell you, this has only happened like a handful of times in my life, where God pushes something on my heart so clearly and with such weight that if I would have heard a voice of God, it wouldn't have been any louder for me. That's how clear it was to me. And as I'm kneeling there before God and sharing my heart with him, what he told me was, Eddie, you are proud. You're proud. And that broke my heart. It broke my heart to think that for the past 3 years I had been serving the Lord, and that I had fallen into a trap, that as I was using my gifting for God, I started using my gifting seeking the affirmation of others and making decisions based off that. And God's saying, I gave that to you so that you could give it back to me, and stop making decisions just, oh, well, people are gonna like that, people aren't gonna like that. And I've fallen into that trap. And what that trap is pride. It's pride. I didn't take the lower position before God with my gifting. And it broke me. And I was lying on my face. I was on my knees, and then I fell flat on my face because I couldn't get low enough before God when he revealed that to me. And I'm weeping, and I could see the puddles of my tears forming on that carpet. And even though I was grieving that September 26, 2006, I will never forget that day, because that was the day God graciously, you have to understand that this is his grace to you, that he revealed to me that I needed to repent of my pride. See, here's the enemy's lie. He wants you to believe that anytime you see something move from weakness to strength, that it's the favor of God. And that's not true. That can't be true. Just because something looking to appear stronger or growing, That doesn't mean God's blessing it. Think of all the false religions out there, right? Think of Islam and Buddhism. Are they growing in certain areas? Of course they are. Does that mean God's blessing it? No, absolutely not. The lie is that any move from weakness to strength is God's favor. That's not the truth. What is the truth is that God wants to move you from weakness to seeing his strength in your weakness. It's in your weakness. Paul says, when I'm weak, then I'm strong. Not after I'm done being weak, then I'm strong. He says, exactly at the moment when I'm weak, then God's strength will come down, and in my weakness, he will show himself to be strong. And everyone will know that it's God's strength, because they'll look at you and they're like, but he's so weak, this doesn't make sense. That's right, because in my weakness, I will boast all the more that as I am weak, then I am strong, only through the power of God. That's the truth. And so then you have to ask yourself, well, then how do I distinguish between the two? If I start seeing things improve, things getting stronger in my life, how do I distinguish? Is this from God or is this something man-made? Well, I believe that the way you distinguish that is the second point of this passage. Is there prayer? Is there prayer? We have to kneel in prayer. We have to walk in humility, but we have to kneel in prayer. The word here for pray is the word pelal, which literally means to break. And in the Hebrew, it also carries a nuance about praying for a dire situation that you are in and that you are seeking God for relief. You know, and it also holds a grammatical function specifying the fact that it's to break is what it literally means, but it also, in this passage, it means to break one's self. That's so interesting to me. The word for pray means to break oneself. That's what the word contrite means. It's the breaking of your heart before God. The word contrite means like to pulverize your heart so that all that's left is dust. And once there's dust, then God steps in and he says, look at what I'm going to make with this dust. You don't know what my potter's hands can do. If you could just pulverize that heart, you just watch me show up. God can do things beyond, you can't even imagine what God can do. Come up with what you think God could do in your life, and then God says, I can do more than that. You can't even fathom what the favor of God could do. But it's your job to pray. It's your job to break yourself. And how do you do that? You pray. You pray. You know, I think I've prayed more in 2019 than I ever had in my whole life in any other given year, and what I discovered is that I've just scratched the surface of what God wants to do in my heart. I feel like I'm in kindergarten in regards to prayer, because the more I find of him, the more I realize, why did it take me so long to get to this place, to be on my knees desperately seeking God? And I want more of that. Every year I want it to be that I don't leave this place. I've just scratched the surface of what God wants to do. And I don't want us as a church to get up off our knees if things start getting better. I don't want it. If circumstances start to improve, I don't want us to get up off our knees. In God's grace, we are now on our knees. And we need to keep the fervency of prayer growing. It's a pillar of our church. We've always believed firmly in the power of prayer. You know, I won't discourage you today with all the statistics I found as I was studying that reveal just how little people actually pray. I'll just say this, it's not much. And that is so sad to think about in the context of this verse, because God is saying, look at all I want to do for you. Look at that then that he gives us. Look at all that he wants to do. But we have to do the if. And one of the ifs is praying. And if that's not enough to get us praying, I don't know what will be. God straight up is saying, look at all the blessing that I want to give you if you'll pray. If you will pray. And somehow that's not enough to get us on our knees. But in God's grace, he gave many of us many reasons in the last 12 months to get on our knees. And now he gives you the opportunity to stay on your knees. We walk in humility, we kneel in prayer, then this, we seek his face. We seek his face. To seek the face of God means to reject self-reliance and seek the person of God. If you're counting up your armies with a census, that's not seeking the face of God. That's saying, I think we could pull this off, God. If you're doing the work of God, but there's no prayer, that's not seeking the face of God. That's self-reliance. There's no power coming from God for you because you're not praying. That's indicative of the fact that you're not seeking his face. But when you choose not to rely on your own strength, then you desperately need to seek God for the capacity to continue. And that's why you seek his face. It reminds me of what the psalmist said in Psalm 63, verse 1. He says this, God, you are my God. Earnestly I seek you. My soul thirsts for you. My flesh faints for you, as in a dry and weary land where there is no water. Do you hear the intensity in that? That's not like a kind, nice verse. That's like, God, I need you. I have to have you. And then he says in Psalm 27, verse 8, you have said, seek my face. My heart says to you, your face, Lord, do I seek. He gives his yes to the Lord. Yes, Lord. God says, seek my face. Reject self-reliance and come to me. Seek my face. See, that's what we're after every single worship service. We're not only after singing the right things about God that are rooted in Scripture, we're not only after expressing ourselves to God the way he's revealed in Scripture, we are after seeking him and seeking him desperately. We sang today, with every breath that I'm able, I will sing of the goodness of God. That's what we want in the worship service, because that is desperately seeking God's face, that we would earnestly seek him. Because if we don't have him, church, if we don't have God, we have nothing. There is no reason to come here on Sundays. If God is not here, why would we come here? Because if we don't have him, we don't have anything. But if we have him, we have everything we need. And you have nothing to fear. Nothing to fear. If he's with us, you have nothing to fear. We walk in humility. We kneel in prayer. We seek his face. And then this, we turn from sin. The passage says that they humble themselves, they pray, they seek his face, and they turn from their wicked ways. The word turn right there is one of the most used verbs in all of the Old Testament. Turn from their wicked ways. It's used over 1,000 times, and 61 of those times is right here in 2 Chronicles. It refers to a change in direction. So in the context of this passage, it's specifically referring to a turning away from sin and a returning to the Lord. It's a change in direction. That is what repentance is. And a change in direction means two things. It's, I was headed here, and now I'm no longer headed there. Now I'm headed here. I was headed here is sin, and I want to change direction away from that and return to the Lord. I don't want to forsake the Lord. I want to seek the Lord. And that's a change in direction. And this message of repentance has become unpopular these days. That grieves my heart. How is it possible that the message of repentance that's all throughout Scripture, it's just not talked about as much? Everyone wants to preach on the love of God. Everyone wants to preach on the grace of God. But if you're choosing to avoid the message of repentance, do you even really value it for what it is? Repentance is beautiful. It's a beautiful thing, though it can be painful. It's beautiful. Scripture says that times of refreshing come through repentance. You want to get out of the dry land, the way out of it is repentance. And so we have to deal with sin. We have to deal with sin. If you walk into 2020 unwilling to turn from sin, unwilling to ask God to reveal the things in your heart that you don't even know are sin, then you will miss out on the then. You're going to miss out on what we're going to be talking about next week. You won't get to have that if you're unwilling to repent. So we have to deal with sin. So let's start with this, known sin. Is there something you know that you have dishonored the Lord with? You know it's against his word. You know it's there, but you're choosing against it. It's sin. That's sin. Or in the last 12 months, did you wound a brother or a sister because you lashed out of your own hurtfulness? Did you lash out in anger as someone came to you in the past 12 months with a question, and then you took it the wrong way and you were angry and you were unloving to your brother or sister? That's sin. It does not honor God. Did you exert a confidence or a defensiveness on topics you didn't have knowledge about in order to appear to be strong or to appear to be right? That's pride. Or were you crippled with fear as you looked to the future? As you stared into the face of the unknown, you were so afraid. God, what could happen next? I'm so afraid. God says, fear not, for I'm with you. You have nothing to be afraid of. Or did that fear lead to anxiety that started to take effect on your body because you were so stressed? God says, be anxious over nothing. Nothing. Be anxious about nothing. Look, Harvest, I'm not up here pointing my finger at you. I did all those things. I sinned against the Lord in those ways. And I've had to repent of all those things. There's known sin, but there's also unknown sin. See, the Bible teaches that the heart, above all other things, you know what it's known for? For being deceitful. It lies to you. It deceives you. There are things in your heart that are so messed up, you don't even know that they're there. You don't even know that they're sitting on your heart because it's deceived you. And what you need to do is ask God to give you the grace of revealing that which is on your heart, that you've been deceived. So the question is, have you prayed that? Have you asked God to do that? God, for what I don't see, would you let me see it? Because once I can see it, then I can confess it. And once I confess it, then I can repent of it, and we can have a change in direction. We have to pray for it, confess known sin, and ask God to reveal unknown sin. These are the things that lead to revival. The heart of revival, at the center of it, is revival in the heart. It's right here. It's revival in the heart. God says, here's what he says. Draw near to me. And then God says, I'll draw near to you. God says, seek me and you will find me. God says, return to me and I will return to you. Do you hear his voice? Do you hear his heart? He's waiting. He wants to do this. He's told us that he wants to do this. But he's not going to do the then if there's no if. If we humble ourselves, if we pray and seek his face and turn from our wicked ways. And as the leaders of this church, we want to take this very seriously. We don't want to rush to the then. We don't want to go too fast, because if we go too fast, then we could easily miss something God wants to revive in our hearts. But because of the pressure that we feel, because of the angst that we feel, we want to get to the blessing as fast as we can. We don't want to do that. We want God to do everything he needs to do in our hearts before we get to the then. More of this, God, more of you, less of us. So here's what we're going to do. We are calling our church to a solemn assembly this Thursday night, 7 p.m. at all our campuses. come back this Thursday night at 7 p.m. What's a solemn assembly? A solemn assembly is the gathering of God's people for the purpose of doing the four things I just preached to you. That's all it is. We're going to humble ourselves together before God. We're going to pray together. We're going to seek His face together. And we're going to turn away from our sin. If you pray today and ask God, God, would you reveal what's in my heart that I don't know is sin against you? Then pray that He would do that before Thursday so that on Thursday you could come and you could just confess that and say, Lord, this is it. I leave this here before you. So we're going to come back this Thursday night, 7 p.m. We're going to cancel everything we can cancel because we want everyone who wants to be here, who wants to do this if, to be here. Thursday night at 7. When I shut up the heavens so that there is no rain, or command the locusts to devour the land, or send pestilence among my people, if my people who are called by my name humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven and I will forgive their sin and I will heal their land. So today I want to give you an opportunity to give your yes to the Lord. For as I've been preaching, I've been going through all these topics in Scripture, and there's something the Holy Spirit said, that's you. That's what I want you to change. I want this change of direction in you. So if He's revealed that to you, the question is, will you give your yes to Him? Will you receive it? So I'm going to give you an opportunity to put a physical action behind the work that God's done in your heart. And across all our campuses, we're opening the front of the church for you to come, for you to kneel before the Lord, and just consecrate that to Him. Say, God, I dedicate, I say yes to you. Whatever it is that the Holy Spirit is moving in your heart, you need to say yes to Him. And coming forward only means that it's just a physical representation of the work that God has already done in your heart. See, we are the next generation of Harvest Bible Chapel. It doesn't matter how old you are or how young you are. It doesn't matter if you've been here 1 week or if you've been here 30 years. You and I, if you're here, we're the next generation of Harvest Bible Chapel. And may it be that this generation is known for humbling themselves. May it be that decades later, people would look back and be like, look at how they prayed. May it be that our children and our children's children would know that this generation sought the face of God, and that we would be known for turning from our sin. God, make us that generation. So you can come now. The front of the church is open. Come lay before the Lord, kneel before Him, commit this to Him as we sing.